I don't wanna grow up, I'm a curious kid. The world has 100 questions I can play with. So I'll open my arms and eyes and wonder every day till the day I die. No one really knows why gravity exists. Naming something doesn't mean that we get it. So I'm
so welcome and thank you everyone for coming to another collaboration of Wonderfest and Ask a Scientist here at Street Food Park. I'm Juliana Gallen, I run Ask a Scientist. This here is Tyler Hiatt, he runs Wonderfest. He's also one of our speakers tonight. Tonight's topic, as you know, physics. Are we out? We're back. And our speakers are two of the Bay Area's most loved high school physics. I'm exaggerating. Are there any students here tonight, former students? I think I saw a couple. There's one in the back. So let me introduce, I'm gonna read their titles because they're both so illustrious. Tucker Hiatt, longtime physics teacher, Stanford Visiting Scholar, emeritus, and Wonderfest founding director. And Marc, Zeke Kossover, I think the Zeke just blipped out. We call him Zeke. He's a longtime physics teacher, Albert Einstein Distinguished Educator Fellow to the National Science Foundation, and teacher in residence and co-director of the leadership program at the Eploratorium. Our format tonight will be the usual. Our speakers will give two short presentations, one before a break, one after the break, and each one will be followed by a chance to ask some questions. We'll have, like I said, a nice long break in the middle to do some experiments and get more beer. I think with that, I will hand the mic over to Tucker and Zeke.
Thank you, Juliana. Eric, are you getting audio and video? You want us to stand here in the light? Is that you, Eric? Eric, is that you? Yeah, good, all right. Thank you for being here tonight. I am Tucker Hiatt. I am excited to be here, and the first thing I have to do for both Zeke and for me is to offer some disclaimers. Oh, and also a clarification. Zeke and I are going to speak for 15 minutes each, roughly, and then we'll have a break with questions and some experimentation. Then we'll return after the break to each do 15 minutes, then followed by questions. So there'll be two question periods. All right, the disclaimers. First up, this will not improve your game. If you're a serious hardball or softball or even a serious little leaguer, this is not going to help your game. The best way to help your game is to practice. But this is going to teach you something about physics. And we have the nerve of physics teachers to believe that physics is very broadly applicable. So it's the physics of baseball. When you're all done, you're going to be able to apply what you've learned here tonight to a lot of other things beyond baseball. All right. So first of all, physics teacher often does right away at the beginning of a class is define the units. Now, I know we're all metric savvy, but I can see that there's this weird unit there, the foot. It's about 30 centimeters, for those of you unfamiliar with it. Thank you, Zeke. All right, so you see nothing too unusual up here. Feet, seconds, pounds for our unit of weight. The mile per hour, also feet per second occasionally. Notice 1 mile per hour is moseying along a very slow walk, and that's about 1.5 feet per second. So let's see. If a pitcher throws a ball via fastball at 90 miles per hour, converting to feet per second, that would be about, 135 feet per second. But it's 66 feet, more or less, between the pitcher's mound and home plate. So that means that the ball, traveling at 135 feet per second, is going to get to the plate in less than half a second. The batter does not have much time to decide whether or not to swing. All right, and then this weird little unit here at the bottom. We've got this unit called the joule, which is our nod to the metric system and represents the unit of energy. And it's weird, the corresponding English unit is the foot-pound or the pound-foot, and it's so alien that I'm hoping tonight one of the byproducts of this talk is that we'll all get more accustomed to using joules, the international unit of energy, except in the United States. All right, so what is a joule? Very vaguely, it's the energy of one handshake, one vigorous up and down motion. So 10 handshakes, 10 joules of energy. A hug, a vigorous hug is about 1 joule of energy. You do about 1 joule of work in conducting 1 vigorous hug. All right, so we'll get more used to this unit. If you do a serious push-up, a full push-up, if you're kind of hefty, it's about 100 joules, all right? Oh, we've got the units down here. All right, now why am I talking about energy? Because energy is incredibly useful. First, consider the utility of energy as harm, all right? In a car crash, if you want to know how badly the victim suffered, the best measure of that is the energy of the collision. Likewise, look at that bottom picture there, a nuclear detonation. That's measured in megatons, which are also units of energy. You can convert that to joules. Clearly, energy can be very destructive. Look at the upper right picture. We have a couple embracing each other, one with a knife and the other with a gun. We suspect that the gun is more lethal than the knife. Bullets are more lethal than blades in general. And that's because, if you had to say it in a word, it's because of energy. Bullets have more energy than blades. All right, but let's do some good. How about the utility of energy for good? All right, there's, of course, solar energy, starting as good old sunlight, turning into electrical energy. We've got people building houses, doing work, using energy to perhaps during a barn building there. And we've got a young woman just exulting, dancing perhaps, displaying her own personal energy. All right, now, the main reason that energy is so useful from a scientific point of view, from a physics point of view, is the deep law of nature that concerns it. And that's the law of energy conservation. I imagine you do remember this from high school, even if you didn't take physics. Everybody learns this maybe in middle school. The total energy of a closed system never changes. Energy can't be created or destroyed. Now here I've got number of joules in, so that's another way of saying this. The number of joules in a so-called closed system, nothing affecting it from the outside, whatever's in this ideal box, never changes its energy. Never, the total number of joules in the box never changes. This is it took people a long time to figure out. Quite a long time after Newton stated his laws of motion, people figured this out. It's one of the great discoveries of humankind. And there are lots of types of energy. Here we see an electric discharge. We see light evident in the visible spectrum. At upper right there, you see a can of Diet Coke that's come from Australia. And in the Coke is food energy, chemical potential energy. And what I hope you notice, maybe it's hard to see here, is that this is low joule cola. We would say low calorie cola, but the rest of the world says low joule. Maybe not the rest, but most of the world. A calorie is another unit of energy. There are all kinds of units because there are so many types of energy. And it took us a long time to figure out that they're all manifestations of the same thing. So there are megatons and ergs and foot-pounds and joules, therms, kilowatt-hours, all kinds of units. But we're going to stick with joules. What's 1 joule? A handshake. Good handshake. Okay. All right. Here is one of those types of energy. Besides the kinds I just referred to, maybe we should call these the forms of energy. And one of them is the kinetic energy, the energy of motion, the energy of the mass of a sprinter like Usain Bolt moving quickly. The energy of a bullet, as I mentioned earlier. And here we see the energy of the kinetic energy of a cliff jumper. And by the way, I want to jump back just for a second. I didn't mention this energy here, wave energy. That's going to turn out to be quite important in our study of baseball, oddly enough. Now, when I say a wave, I want you to realize this is quite an exceptional wave. This is a breaking wave. The vast majority of waves in the world of all sorts don't break. This is very unusual, but you get the idea. A wave is a systematic disturbance in material, in something. All right, so here we go. Back here to kinetic energy, the energy of motion. Potential energy. There are two subtypes of potential energy. This gravitational potential energy. This woman has it by virtue of her altitude, her distance off the ground. She's got gravitational potential energy. And this young man has elastic potential energy in the stretched, what is that called? Slingshot. Elastic potential energy. All right. And the third kind of energy that we'll need tonight is thermal energy. What you see is a very slow motion representation of a cubic object made of atoms, say, falling onto something that evidently is not made of atoms. That bottom yellow platform will also be made of atoms, but all right. Now let me play this again. And just before I start it, I want you to see that we're gonna start with the object elevated. This blue-gray cube made of atoms starts with gravitational potential energy. But because energy is conserved, as it loses its gravitational potential energy, some other form of energy must result from the loss of potential energy. And sure enough, it's kinetic energy, a fall. But then as soon as the impact happens, think baseball on a baseball bat, as soon as the impact happens, the atoms vibrate more than they used to. With every impact, the thermal energy of the ball or of this cube increases, represented by the agitation, the vibration of those internal particles. All right, so we have kinetic energy, the energy of motion. Potential energy, the energy of position in gravity, or the energy of a stretched material, elastic potential energy, and the energy of heat, thermal energy. So let's consider some baseball example, conservation of energy at work. Am I dropping out too frequently to be understood? You're wishing that would happen? No, this is not gonna happen. All right, how about an upper deck foul ball? Part of the reason I love to watch Giants games on TV is that I enjoy the commentary of Mike Kruko. I find him to be quite engaging. And his motto is that if you come to the ballpark, you bring a glove. And so I brought a glove today just in case I get to catch a foul ball. That's the idea. He says, bring a glove, catch a ball. It'll happen if you bring your glove. So I can't afford very good seats, so when I do go to the ballpark, I'm way up there in the upper deck. And I've come to realize that I don't need to bring my mitt, because although the ball may leave the bat going, even as much as 120 miles per hour, with a lot of kinetic energy, therefore, because that's the energy of motion, by the time that ball rises to where I'm sitting, nosebleed territory, it has gained so much potential energy that it must have lost a lot of kinetic energy. And sure enough, it's not moving quickly at all when it finally gets up to my territory. So if you're in the upper deck with me, don't bother bringing your ball glove. It'll actually impede your ability to scramble for the ball against me. All right, simple vertical toss. I gotta do this with my left hand. This is gonna be ugly. All right, if I chuck the ball upward, you know that I'm doing the same sort of transformation of energy. The energy after the ball leaves my hand, the ball has kinetic energy, energy of motion, turning into potential energy at the top, and then coming back down as kinetic energy in my hand. And that's fairly simple to understand, but you got to think about what happens if a baseball player with a really good arm plays catch with him or herself. Suppose I were to chuck a true fastball straight up, 100 miles per hour. Well, if there's no other kind of energy involved, if it's just kinetic at the start and potential at the top and kinetic when it comes back down, then I'm going to be catching 100 mile per hour fastball when the ball comes back down to me. Now, fortunately, there is another kind of energy involved. As the ball moves upward and downward, it has to move air out of its way. The ball plows through the air, and in doing so, heats the air and itself. So in my analysis there, just involving kinetic, potential, and then back to kinetic, I neglected heat, thermal energy. When the ball comes back down, It won't be going 100 miles per hour, the speed of my throw, maybe. It might be going 90 or 80. Still a hard throw, but not as fast as it was going when it went up. And finally, this thick catcher's glove, well, not quite finally, but you know, I've just got an infielder's mitt here, but if I'm repeatedly catching fastballs from a serious major league pitcher, I'm gonna want a thick glove, because the main function of a glove is, we would say, to cushion, but a physicist would say would be to convert the kinetic energy of the pitch into thermal energy, to thermalize the energy of the pitch. And if you've got a big, thick glove, that will help to thermalize the glove rather than your hand. Now, there are other factors. The simple cushioning is not described well in terms of energy. But it is significant that a part of the reason for a thick catcher's glove is to thermalize energy better than a thin glove. All right, and finally here, soon after the break, we'll come back and consider the sweet spot on a baseball bat, the so-called best place at which to hit the ball to attain a good long ball or powerful hit is the so-called sweet spot. We'll use our understanding of energy to try to figure out why there is a sweet spot and where it is on a bat. All right, before I turn the mic over to Zeke, I want to just remind you of the properties of a baseball. They're about 3 inches in diameter. This is a hard ball now, you know, major league style ball. They weigh about a quarter of a pound, 5 ounces. If well thrown, they're going 90 miles per hour, which means their energy is about 120 joules. Now remember, I said a good vigorous push-up, deep push-up, down and up, was about 100 joules. So it seems like that's not very much, 120 joules. But imagine having that energy concentrated under your shoulder, say, if you're hit by a pitch. That's really going to hurt. It probably won't break a bone unless the bone's very small, but that's 120 joules when concentrated is a lot of energy. And finally, we've got to consider the elasticity of the ball. Here we see a genuine photo that is not an inflatable baseball. That's a major league regulation baseball hitting a baseball bat at the speed when a bat is swung at top speed at a ball, that's how much the ball compresses. So I think you can see a baseball at least looks like it has to have some elastic properties, because that ball is going to spring back to its original shape after this impact. And what about the bat itself? Zeke's going to talk to us about bats. 3 feet long, 2.5 inches wide, more or less, at the barrel. All of these are some variation that the league allows. Weight is just about 2 pounds. And the speed, if you've really got a good swing, you can get the business end of that bat going at 70 miles per hour. And the energy, therefore, the kinetic energy of the swing, is about 400 joules at the moment of truth, the MOT. That's when the bat meets the ball. All right, and the bats are made, major league bats are almost all either ash or maple. All right, Zeke, we have to do a quick computer swap and then Zeke will take over.
So my job is to explain to you about what happens with the baseball is in the air at this point. So we'll start with, this is a baseball. The most interesting thing about the baseball, am I too loud? The most interesting thing about a baseball, is that better? The most interesting thing about a baseball is that it's not as smooth as you would expect. It has a history. When it was first made, they had to make it with stitches to hold it together. We don't have to make balls that way anymore. For example, soccer balls were once stitched together, and they're no longer stitched together. They're glued together, and this year's World Cup ball was quite smooth, and you might have known that that caused troubles in the World Cup. Baseballs, though, we keep them stitched with those big, heavy laces on the outside, and that's going to be an essential part of the discussion of baseballs. So the forces that act on a baseball, the first one is gravity. That pulls the baseball downwards. But the baseball also moves through the air, and so it has another force on it called drag. Drag slows the baseball down. Now, you might be wondering why that happens. So here's our baseball going through a field of blue dots that I'm using to represent air. It looks just like air. Like, if you could see really small things, it would look like blue dots. You should trust me. I work at the Eploratorium. So the arrow is representing the direction of the ball moving through the air. And as it moves through the air, it runs into air molecules. In the front of it, it needs to get those air molecules out of the way. And behind it, it leaves an empty space where new air molecules have to go in. With me so far? All right, to move those air molecules out of the way takes energy. It's got to push them. And that energy has to come from somewhere. Where does that energy come from? The kinetic energy of the ball. So if the ball gives up energy to move the air, then the ball necessarily has to have less energy, and so the ball has to slow down. Does that make sense? That's the simplest explanation you'll ever have of drag. The bigger the ball is, the more air molecules it runs into. And if it runs into more air molecules, it has to move more air molecules. And if it has to move more air molecules, it'll slow down more. Wow, that is a weird... Oh, Oracle, how nice of them. Has anyone ever figured out why Java feels the compulsion to call home every 20 minutes or so? I'm not worried about the NSA, I'm worried about Java. So this picture here is trying to demonstrate how the air molecules, which are trying to get away from the ball, they get to push towards it, get compressed together around the edge of the ball. And these air molecules move around the ball, but because they have sort of forward velocity, they move away from the ball, they get detached from the ball, leaving, well, it's not really an empty space. It's a space with less air behind the ball. Does that make sense so far? You can experience this yourself if you go to a swimming pool. If you put your hand in the water and push the water forward like this, it'll leave a depression behind it. Water will build up in front of your hand. You'll have a little lump of water in front, and then you'll have less water behind. That less water behind is called a wake. And it's exactly the same thing in the air. There's a wake behind the ball, and then there's a boundary layer around the ball with extra air in it. The thing is that boundary layer, look at the difference between these two pictures here. In this first one, the boundary layer is fairly far away from the edge of the ball, leaving a big wake behind it. In this picture, the boundary layer is closer to the surface of the ball, leaving a smaller wake behind it. Now, if I want the boundary layer to fill in the spot behind the ball faster, and I suppose I should take a break and say, why would I want that to happen? Well, when the air is in front of the ball building up and behind the ball there's an empty space, that pushes backwards on the ball and slows the ball down, just like it does with your hand in the water. When you have that big lump of water in front of your hand, it slows your hand down. We want to get rid of that big lump. We want to, as quickly as possible, take the air from the front of the ball and move it to the back. In this picture here, that doesn't happen very quickly because the air swoops around the ball very quickly and detaches from it. If we could have some way to glue the air to the ball so that the air would stick closer to the ball, then there wouldn't be as big a gap behind it, and there wouldn't be as big a wake, and there wouldn't be as much drag. And there is a way to do that with a ball. They're called laces. The roughness of the ball literally grabs air and brings air with it around the ball as it moves through the air. Now, there is a limit to this, as you might imagine, but a little bit of roughness on the ball actually makes the ball go faster than a smooth ball does. If you've ever wondered why tennis balls are fuzzy, it's not because it'd be cool that they're fuzzy. I mean, they are warm and fuzzy. But it also makes it go faster because it keeps the air attracted to the surface of the ball. And so the laces on the ball and the roughness of the ball, the fact that it's not super smooth leather, that makes the ball actually move faster through the air because it reduces the wake. Nonetheless, the wind resistance is nothing to sneeze at, and the drag really quite decreases the speed of the ball. So this is some data from Michael Richman about a pitched ball. So if you pitch a ball at 100 miles an hour, when it goes a mere 60 feet 6 inches from the pitcher's mound to the plate, it's actually less than that. It's about 55 feet because the pitcher's allowed to stretch forward. They kind of cheat the game, I think. In bowling, are you allowed to do that? If you keep 1 foot back, are you allowed to stretch forward and bowl? No. In volleyball, are you allowed to go across the net? No. Oh, wait, I'm tall. I'm supposed to like that. I think that's a fantastic rule that I am allowed to reach closer to the home plate. In any case, it goes from 100 to 88 miles an hour, even in that short distance of just 20 yards. It goes from 90 to 80, as you can see on the chart over there. So that drag slows things down quite quickly. We'll come back to this in a moment. But so during that time, that means that the ball slows down and doesn't go as far as you would expect. So this graph here shows how... So this red line here, is that red? I'm colorblind. I'm going to go with red. The long one's red. Great, thank you. That's how far, if I were at at Giant Stadium, at AT&T Park, I'm not calling it AT&T. I'm calling it Giant Stadium. If I were there and I were to hit a ball and there were no air, this is how far the ball would go, 571 feet. Way out into McCovey Cove. However, wind resistance plays an important factor. And the ball, instead of going that distance, because of the drag, it slows the ball down, and so it only makes it 397 feet. The main reason for that is that it just doesn't spend as much time in the air. Because it isn't in the air as long, then the ball doesn't go as far. The longer you can make it stay in the air, the farther it goes. Anyone who's played Frisbee has experienced this, right? If you can make the Frisbee stay in the air, it will actually go to your target. For me, it usually turns over like this, hits somebody nearby. I don't get it quite as far as I'd like. That's why I stick to hitting home runs in baseball. All right, a couple more things that relate to this before our time is up. So let's imagine you're at the ballpark and you are watching and you see the pitcher throw the ball to home plate. If you were very clever, you could graph this motion. I actually see a person in the back saying, no one told me there were going to be graphs tonight. Already there have been two. But this is actually exactly what you would have if you could just shoot high-speed photography of the ball on the way to the plate. Bump, 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 bump. The question is, and when I was showing this to some students at the Eploratorium, they said to me, Zeke, why is the ball ending up down here? What does that mean that the ball has done this? The person's thrown the ball. Well, of course, the reason is that just because you throw something doesn't mean you make it not fall. Gravity works on it even when it's moving forward. So it falls through the air as it comes down. So its ball starts up here about 6.5 feet high and finishes up at about 2.5 or 2.75 feet high, which is good. That's the strike zone for most people. Okay? Each one of these dots represents 1/100 of a second, and the dots with the circles are 0.41 seconds. So that's about 0.41 seconds from the pitcher's hand to home plate. If you want to get a sense of how fast that is, we can do a little demonstration. You ready for a little demonstration? All right, please. If you get out a dollar bill, please, and then pass it up to me. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. If you'll just get out a bill, that would be fantastic. Only each pair needs to do that. I will find my wallet.
By the way, after this demonstration, if you're wondering what to do with this 20 you've taken out of your wallet, there's a comely, the Wonderfest spokesmodel named Kendra Kramlich, who will be happy to accept your donation.
So I need both hands to do this. So I'm going to switch off the microphone for a second and talk very loudly. All right, so what you're going to do is you're going to take your bill like this. It's pretty straightforward. You just take your bill, you put your fingers in the middle over George's face. One person holds the bill, the other person tries to catch it. First one drops, second person catches. Couldn't be any easier than that. Couldn't be any easier. Here, let me try it up here. I bet you weren't ready for that. Here, let me try that again. Did you move your hand down to catch that? I did not tell you that was against the rules, I suppose.
Put your catching hand on the edge of a table so you can't move the hand down.
So another 30 seconds to work on that. Just be happy I didn't use this as a bar bet. Half of you all would love me now, and the other half would hate me.
Don't put those bills away. Do not put those bills away.
So why is it so difficult to catch the bill? Well, it turns out that it takes time for your mind to recognize that the bill is falling, and it takes time for you to decide to squeeze your fingers together. And in that time, the bill has been falling all of that time because you didn't have a chance to guess ahead of time. Why could I do such a good job of catching the bill? Because I know when I'm going to drop it, I hope. And actually, we can figure out about what your reaction time, about where you caught it. For example, if you caught it like on, if you started at the top with your finger at the bottom of the bill, and you caught it on his nose, that would mean you had a reaction time about 4.1 seconds. But it turns out most people can't catch the bill even if they start at the bottom, because most people's reaction time is about 0.2 seconds. And if it takes the ball 0.4 seconds to go from the pitching mound to home plate, that means that the poor batter does not have a lot of time to decide to catch the ball. All right, though, back to the idea of drag. So here's the ball, it's being thrown. The red dotted line is what would happen if there's no drag. The black dotted line is actually what happens because there is drag. The reason why I'm not actually showing you a video of a ball moving through the air is I can't show you the red one. We have not yet played baseball on the moon so that there's no air. And most stadiums, even if they have a bad atmosphere there, they still have air. That was a good joke, you could have laughed. Thank you. Although I'll take the pity, doesn't matter. The black line represents the ball. And in fact, the ball will, if the pitcher throws the ball horizontally, drag is such a big deal that the ball will actually hit the ground before it gets to home plate. Luckily that the pitcher has something that the pitcher can do about that. They can put rotation on the ball. Now you're probably wondering to yourself, how does rotation help that? Well, the ball is in a sea of air. And the boundary layer, the air moving next to the ball, is represented by that blue arrow going around. So if the ball is moving that way to your left. Oops, sorry. Then it runs into some air at the top. Can you see that air marked in red at the top up there? So it grabs that air, and the rotation is going to suck that air because it's going to stick to the ball. Why is that air going to stick to the ball? Because of stitches, because the ball is rough. It does not have very small people on the ball catching the air as it goes around. It is also not magnetic. Air is not magnetic. It's because of the roughness and the stitches. That grabs air and pulls the air around and pushes the air downwards behind the ball. And because the air gets pushed downwards, the ball gets pushed upwards. And that's called the Magnus effect. So if the pitcher, when he pitches the ball, throws the ball like this and then lets the ball roll off his fingers like that, then as the ball is moving through the air, it will grab air in the front, roll it to the back, and push the ball upwards so it won't fall as quickly. And in fact, this is some high-speed footage from a wind tunnel, and hopefully you can see how the streams of air are getting deflected by going through the wind tunnel. I turned it around, though, because the streams are actually coming from this side, and we've been doing it this way the whole time, so I think that'd be easier to see. The air gets pushed downwards at an angle, and so the ball gets pushed upwards at that same angle. And that slows the ball down some, because that arrow is pushing in the wrong direction for it, but it also lifts the ball up. And so we trade some of the energy of the rotation of the ball to holding the ball up in the air so it doesn't fall as fast. And so now if you would see this from the third baseman's point of view, instead of having the ball be this low down when it gets to home plate, the ball ends up being this high up when it gets to the home plate if the pitcher puts the rotation on the ball. It means that if the pitcher puts less rotation on the ball or more rotation on the ball, even with the same release point, even from releasing it at the same spot, even pushing it at the same hardness, so his arm is moving at the same speed, you make the ball end up at a different height when it gets to the batter. That makes it, I heard someone in the back just say, it sucks to be a batter. Yes, it does. It's terrible. The pitcher can do awful things to you with just the rotation of the ball. So this is the sort of angle that you would be seeing if you're the pitcher looking at the ball and the direction of the rotation on the ball. And they actually describe this. If you were into baseball, if you were coaching baseball, you would call this a 12-6 rotation, meaning you're going straight up and down. But you could also move it at an angle at a 1-7 rotation. And if you do a 1-7 rotation, the ball isn't just lifted upwards, the ball is also pushed sideways. And that's the classic slider or curveball. The rotation one direction makes it curve one way, and one makes it curve the other way. So the pitcher can both control the height of the ball when it gets to the batter and can move it side to side as well. To demonstrate it, I have a couple of toys. So this guy here, this little cardboard highlight toy, makes sure that the ball has a lot of rotation when it comes out of it. And you'll notice that the ball won't go straight when I throw it. It curves as it goes through the air. You ready? If you've got a drink, maybe you hold on to it so it doesn't fall over if I hit it. It's styrofoam, but whatever. Ready? All right, so we're going to take a break in just a moment, but there's one thing we want to do. We have a little toy for you to play with during the break. Because I do work at the Eploratorium, and one of the things we do there is like to have things for you to play with and touch. So you're going to get, we're going to pass these around, you're going to get a little trough like this, and it's going to have a little top. Put the trough on the table. Not on your hand, on the table, and then spin the top. And guess what? There's a pointy side of the top. You should spin it on the pointy side. It is, however, not pointy enough to hurt your neighbors with. Please don't try. Actually, I can't guarantee it won't hurt your neighbors. So
these guys could hurt somebody.
Someone will figure out a way. So please just don't do it. Spin the top, and then from about this distance away, blow on the top. And you should be able to make the top go, depending on which way you spin it, either to the right or to the left. So you can spin it one way or you can spin it the other way and get a sense of it. So you'll have a chance to play with these during break.
So you'd think that the top would just fall over, but instead it moves laterally.
Yeah. You might think that the top would just blow backwards, but the little trough is the magic part of that. If you just do this on the table, it'll just blow away. And if you blow too close to it, you will tip the top over. That's not what we're trying to get at either. So about this distance away, blowing on the top.
So as Zeke and I hand out these toys, Juliana will talk to you about the question and answer period here in, after the first half.
So, yeah, we have time for a few questions before the break. Is this mic working now? It sounds like it is. All right, any questions? Hands up. Right here.
How does the seams interacting with the air, what's that? Is that turbulence? And is that why the soccer balls were a problem?
Yes. So the seam with the air is turbulent, although pretty much all the flow with a baseball in the air is always turbulent. Baseballs rarely have laminar flow, but the soccer balls sometimes were smooth enough and sometimes moving through the air slow enough that they were getting laminar flow, which means that you tended to get more what's called boundary layer separation, that part where the air moves away, and so it wouldn't bend as much. So like the soccer players intentionally kick the ball off on the side in a corner kick to get more bend on the soccer ball. Was that your question? Yeah.
I may be getting ahead of you, but it seems to me that there are more bats being broken in the modern game than there were 30 years ago or so. Is that accurate?
So we'll talk about that in the second. So that's I understand that is true. And my impression for that is that players in the 1970s and 80s, they started to realize that lighter bats were better, made you bat better. We're going to talk about that right after the break. That consequently, players have gotten, the handles are thinner on the bats, and so they seem to break more. There is a conspiracy theory that the wood is worse. I suspect that that's probably not true. Yeah.
So a knuckleball essentially defies the laws of physics because there's no rotation on the ball, and there's very low velocity. So how does that work?
So one option, like if I want to toss you a baseball and because I don't have a very good arm and can't put much rotation on it, and by the way, don't worry, I'm not actually going to do it, is I would arc the ball through the air. So I'd sacrifice some forward velocity to make it stay in the air for longer. Knuckleballers throw the ball so that it's aiming upwards. You only have to throw upwards by about at 70 miles an hour, you only have to throw it upwards about 5 degrees for it to be in the strike zone at home plate. But the reason why regular pitchers prefer not to do that is that a batter can see that the ball is moving up, they're throwing it upwards, and that clues them in to what the pitch is going to be. But of course, since no one knows where a knuckleball is going to end up, then that's perfect. It doesn't make any difference. It just makes them all the more go, "Wah, I don't know what's going to happen." Yeah.
When I was taught how to throw a changeup, one of the things my coaches told me was to try to make the ball slip through your fingers so that it rotates less. Is that because a ball that rotates less is slower?
That's right. So you want if you make the ball rotate less, it moves slower through the air, and it changes its, you know, the like if you can throw the ball with exactly the same motion as you were throwing a fastball, then even though the ball is going slower, the batter will swing too soon and the ball will get past them.
When the air molecules are moved away from the backer ball, what fills in that empty space?
So the question was, when the air molecules are moved to the back of the ball, what fills in the empty space? So I have greatly exaggerated it on the screen. The boundary layer, the air that's away from it is only a couple millimeters. There is a fairly large area of decreased air pressure. That is, there's some air in there, but there's not the full amount of air pressure right now. If you see a truck driving down the street and it drives over trash or something, you'll see the trash fly up towards the back of the truck. Do you know what I'm talking about? And that's from that reduced air pressure pushing on the trash towards the truck, towards the back of the truck. And that's the same situation. It's not a vacuum. It's just a little bit less air.
Any more pre-break questions? All right.
So when they're measuring the speed of the pitch, is it the initial speed or the final speed?
Huh, that's a fantastic question. I met a person about 2 years ago who officially radar guns the speeds of pitches. And it turns out that a standard radar gun gets the fastest speed. Because there's the radar guns, actually, lots of things are moving in the field of view of the radar gun. And the radar gun just looks for the fastest thing because that's how it detects it between all the other things that are in its field. However, the new pitch FX systems combine both video, high-speed video and radar together, and they can catch the speed at the beginning of the pitch and the speed when it crosses the plate, which is, frankly, kind of amazing. If you don't know about pitch FX, I'll send a link. I'll put some links up for it. They have recorded every pitch from every pitcher in the last dozen years or so, and they have amazing stuff. And they're now recording. They're just starting last year. They're going to try to record every single thing that happens on the field, every throw, every run, every catch. Wow. Thank you. I have a quick. Just a quick video here. Ooh, this is hard to see. Well, let's see if you can see it. Can you see the, he's marked on the ball the seams so that you can see it move through the air. And you see how that ball went almost completely straight? It went through the air. Here, I'll run it one more time. It's going almost completely straight because he's throwing one of these 12-6 rotations. The ball isn't falling as fast as you might expect because he's putting all that backspin on it, and that's holding it up. But it is going straight through the air. But in this one, he's going to throw sideways. And you can see how much the ball bends because of the sideways. So now the force makes it move to the If you've ever wanted to take these kind of videos yourself and you don't have a high-speed camera, you can actually do it in the dark. Take little LED lights, like the kind you might have on a keychain, and turn them on and attach them to your hands with, you know, glue, and to a ball with, say, hot glue, and be careful about the difference between those two things. And you can get, some of them blink when they're on their low setting, a thing called an iNova. And then you can just take a picture fully in the dark, and you'll be able to see those dots are the motion of the ball. And so you can see in this one at the top, see the sort of red and white dots moving across? The ball's motion has very little rotation in that one. But in this one, see how the red and white dots along that top line swap with each other? That's the ball rotating on its axis as it goes past. So this is not actually too hard for you to do if you've ever felt like you wanted to figure out how this worked yourself. Oh, and this is from the point of view, looking straight at the pitcher. I met the person at the Eploratorium who took this picture. She said she's in the dark with her expensive camera, and a guy claims to be able to pitch and not hit her. All right, we need to move on to another activity, and this is the second part of our presentation. This is the other half of the game, that's swinging the bat. So he's moving the bat around, and you have to move the bat around in an arc to be able to hit the ball. If you were to go to the store, if you're a major league player, you have very few choices about a wooden bat. The one thing you can choose is a little bit about the length and about the weight. Back in the bad old days, people used very heavy bats, about 40 ounces. But in the 80s, even before that, people like started using lighter and lighter bats. The lightest legal wooden bat in major leagues is 31 ounces. And currently, the best hitters in the field all use either 31, 32, or 33 ounces. Even Barry Bonds, the great slugger, assuming the juice wasn't all that it was, he played with one of the lightest bats in the game. Big guy, light bat. And it seems like an odd thing, because you might expect to want to use a heavier bat. Like, I don't choose to use the lightest weight hammer I can find when I'm driving a nail. I don't say, hey, can I have that play school hammer? That looks like the one I want to use. And it turns out that it's a little bit subtle what the reason is for why you want a lightweight bat. And I have a demonstration here, which I think will kind of give away the game. So let me show you it. I essentially have a two-armed bat here. And I have this little bottle of water that's going to apply a force to my two-armed bat. So here we'll pull it to the top. And now we're going to let this bottle full of water start to rotate our bat downwards. So it's spinning it up as the bottle of water is pulling down. Can you do this in a more sophisticated way? Of course you can. Can you do it in a pretty simple way and still show what you want to show? I think that's pretty cool. Can you see the bat? Can you see that the bat's getting faster and faster as it's going downwards? But it's never getting very fast. It's not all that fast, is it? All right, let's change up. So I've now changed the ends of my bat. And what I changed about the ends is that the new ends that I put on it are about half the weight of the first ends. The first ones were filled with sand. These are empty. How many people think it won't change how fast these arms will turn? If you don't think it'll change how fast the arms will turn, raise your hand now. If you think that it will make the arms turn slower because they're hollow now, raise your hand. If you think that they'll turn faster now, raise your hand. So you can see already how much quicker it's spinning it on the way down. And so the reason why players want lighter bats is because it lets them turn the bat faster. And turning the bat faster is a really big advantage. It doesn't let you hit the ball as hard, although you can get the bat going faster. But the real advantage is it means you can wait 5 extra milliseconds. For me, that would not be any advantage, but I'm not a Major League Baseball player. And in a Major League Baseball player, that means you can actually wait a few extra feet before you decide whether you're going to swing the bat. And that is a big deal. In fact, it's such a big deal even for non-Major League Baseball players that if you were to go to the store and buy a bunch of Little League bats, you can buy them in a variety of weights, all the way down to the Combat CB-YB1, which is 30 inches long and only 18 ounces. In a wooden bat, that would be 32 ounces. It's 14 ounces lighter than the same wooden bat. And the advantage for a player is a big deal. That one lets them have almost 50 extra milliseconds to decide whether or not they're going to swing the bat. And indeed, someone up in front just said that can't be legal. So they have a really bizarre rule in the NCAA on bat rules, and most high schools have adopted the same one, and it's called the -3 rule. And that is, take the length of your bat in inches, so let's say it's 32 meters long, then the weight can't be any less than three. The weight in ounces can't be any less than three from the length. So if it was a 31-inch bat, they can't weigh less than 28 ounces. If it's a 40-inch bat, it can't weigh less than 37 ounces. It's kind of a dumb non-physics-y rule, which irritates the living, but it's easy to figure out and involves the magic baseball rule of three. And I think that's how they selected it. I'm not making this up. The NCAA is actually moving to a different rule in the next few years. This is already preliminarily, but they have been going with this rule for quite some time. And you can actually really see this if you'd like to demonstrate this yourself. Like, if you try to swing a bat by swinging in your wrists like this, you can get a feel for what it's like. But then take the same bat and put it in the middle like this, and you can feel that if the weight's closer to your hands, that makes it easier to swing as well. So it's not just the total weight of the bat, but the distribution of the weight as well, trying to get the weight close to your hands for swinging the bat. That's the main reason that the major leagues have stuck with wooden bats. It's not tradition, not, oh, I like the sound of the crack of the wooden bat instead of the ping of aluminum. It's that it would make the game really different if you could switch to an aluminum bat. The players would be able to hit the ball, balls that would normally be strikes or normally ones they'd whiff on. And they'd also be able to hit the balls far harder as well, because they'd have more velocity on the ball. And so, since that's such a useful thing, that's why players occasionally cork their bat. That means they take the end of the bat and drill a hole in it, and then slip something into the hole so that the bat won't get crushed. Right? The bat's weaker once you've drilled it out, and so they put something in so that it'll stay strong, and then they glue it back on the top and paint the bat so you won't be able to tell that that's happened. It's actually kind of hard to catch someone doing this. There are several players who have, now that they've retired, admitted to using corked bats. One, in fact, in 1961, won the batting title. But famously, Sammy Sosa's bat cracked because it does make it weaker, and that was kind of embarrassing for him afterwards. So this has happened from time to time. All right, that's all that I have in my portion. A quick reminder again, if you'd like to see how to do some of these demonstrations or you'd like some of these slides, please feel free to contact www.kossover.net or call the or contact the Exploratorium. I'm affectionately known as the other Zeke at the Exploratorium, because here we don't have that many employees and there are two people named Zeke. Oh, and tops, you should have been able to, if you spun it one way, it should have air. And rotation as a baseball does, because the holes in it make it grab the air more strongly for it. If you would really like to keep this and bring it home,
thank you, Zeke. Eric, are the slides visible with that light, or can you dim it at all? I've got a dim bulb in my projector, too. All right. Thank you. That's good. No. Oh, Eric's got a remote control for the light. Oh, man. All right. Okay. Here we see in very slow motion the deformation of the ball when it meets the bat. Let me play that again for you. Now, to be sure, this is a case of a ball being fired from a cannon, an air cannon, that makes the ball go at about 150 miles per hour. That speed is used because, let's suppose you have a pitcher throwing the ball at 90 miles per hour towards home plate, but the batter is swinging the bat in the other direction relative to home plate at maybe 60 miles per hour. So when the ball meets the bat, their relative speed is the sum of those two speeds. 90 miles per hour plus 60 miles per hour, 150 miles per hour. And here's what happens to the ball. All right. Now, how elastic is a baseball? Here you see a table showing balls of different sorts dropped into a very hard surface from 10 feet. 10 foot long, and each division is 1 foot. And you see how the balls rank down here. Perhaps it's hard to read them, so let me describe which ball is which. We have a table tennis ball, a baseball, a golf ball, a soccer ball, tennis ball, basketball, super ball, and at the top of the list, the bounciest ball of all is a steel ball on a steel plate. Now, it's very surprising. At the Eploratorium, there is a very cool exhibit. In a partial vacuum, with magnetism, you're allowed to raise a ball a few inches, a steel ball, above a steel plate, and then you can force the ball to be released. And you proceed to watch this steel ball bounce. A very long time. With every fall, it loses about 2% of its energy. So it's amazing that steel on steel is very elastic. By comparison, we have a baseball here going up to only about 32, well, look at the bottom of the ball here. There's 1 foot, 2 foot, three feet, a little more than 3 feet. 32% of the energy is returned. Now, why do we know it's energy here? Because remember, altitude indicates gravitational potential energy. So let's say this baseball had 10 joules of energy up here when the drop started. It fell down, hit the ground. Maybe the ground is a very hard wooden bat-like floor. The ball bounces back up just to 3 feet and a couple of inches. That represents 32% of the gravitational energy that the ball had at the start. That's a way of describing the bounciness of a baseball. 32% of energy is lost. All right, how about the bat? Well, you've seen this graph, this data table or this list before here. Here's why we're talking about bats again. Here's a very sweet swing. Bat-ball collision, sweetly, done by Marco Scudero at the 2012 National League Championship Series. This is a game that helped to make him famous back in that year. And it wasn't a home run, but it's a solid line drive. And the bat is being hit by the ball, thanks to Marco's careful positioning, on the so-called sweet spot. The idea is that he wants to get the most energy out of the bat-ball collision that he can. He wants the kinetic energy of the ball to be greatest so that its speed is the greatest. All right, here's another kind of bat-ball collision. This is also a giant. This is Brandon Crawford, same game, same series, and he's doing a bunt here. Notice how much the ball slows down. Of course, it's already in slow motion here, but you can still tell the ball definitely gives up some of its kinetic energy. When Scudero hit the ball gained kinetic energy. Here, when Crawford's hitting it, because he's letting the ball hit the bat and do some work on the bat, slowing the ball down as the bat speeds up, the energy of the ball is thermalized. That bat and actually Crawford's body, hands and arms, are getting warmer than in the case of the collision with Scudero hitting the ball. And here is that Scudero case again. Here the ball speeds up, and notice Scudero's bat slows down a bit. The kinetic energy of the ball, however, is greater. That extra kinetic energy has come at the expense of the kinetic energy of the bat. The bat is slowed down. All right. Here's a different Scudero hit. Here we can see where the ball hits in this diagram of the bat. The bat's about 34 inches long. And you can see the bat actually splinters. Watch also what happens to the ball. It's falling downward, not because Scudero's aim was bad, but because so much energy has been sapped from the ball. That energy went, in part, to breaking the bat. Here's another famous break. This is Hunter Pence, same series. Hunter Pence, in breaking his bat, manages to hit the ball continuously, though, three different times. But we can see that if the sweet spot is somewhere over here, oh, that's where it is, right there, then where Pence is hitting the ball is here, and we can see how the bat flexes. It flexes and breaks. Most of the cracking of bats, by the way, is not as dramatic as we just saw. The bat usually just cracks. It doesn't splinter and fall apart like this. All right, so sometimes the colliding ball and bat put a lot of their energy into the bat as waves and vibrations. Now, oddly, we just saw the bat break. We didn't see really waves and vibrations. But let's try another view. Let's take a view with an aluminum bat, the kind of bat that Zeke mentioned earlier. Aluminum bat like this. Yes. All right. Here's an aluminum. Oh, excuse me. This is a statement about sometimes, but what's more important here is about some places. At some places on the bat, the rebounding ball and bat put a lot of their energy into the bat as waves or vibrations. That is, kinetic energy of the swing and the ball becomes elastic or wave energy in the bat, but not at the sweet spot. So let's see that sweet spot where you want to make connection between the bat and the ball. Nice. We don't see the bat vibrating very much. It is, but not much. So let's see a bat and ball collision that's not so sweet. Here's one beyond, outside the sweet spot, and you can see, I think you can see, watch, here it comes again, same swing. Beyond the sweet spot, you can see the waves propagate down the bat and go to the batter's hand. This leads to quite a nasty feeling in the hands, especially the top hand. Here's another sweet spot missed in a swing. This one's going to be inside the sweet spot. And you can actually see the fingers of the batter respond as the wave travels from the ball impact site to his hand. Let's watch that again. Here's inside the sweet spot. Yeah. All right. I'm going to come back to some videos now that are going to show you a ball hitting a wooden bat. But keep your eye on the ball, because remember, the goal here in hitting a ball is to make it get as much kinetic energy as possible, unless you're bunting, of course. Ball meets bat at a relative speed of 150 miles per hour. Now, that's at the sweet spot. Let's watch that again. Now, watch the ball. Let me do that one more time. Okay. The ball definitely loses energy when it hits the bat, and there are waves that travel down the bat. But now let's compare that to a case where the bat hits the ball inside of the sweet spot. I think you see quite a bit more waving inside the bat. The bat vibrates more, and the ball goes more slowly. Here it is again. You can see the wave course through the wooden bat, and the ball is moving less slowly. If the ball is giving energy to waves in the bat, vibration of the bat molecules, then the ball is going to have less energy, less kinetic energy. And let's go to perhaps the ultimately bad non-sweet spot swing. Here it comes. Yeah, here we see the bat fracture and the ball gain very little energy as it bounces off. Right, the ball have very little energy returned as it bounces off the bat. See that one more time. Yeah, look at how slowly that ball is going. It barely bounces back up above the bat. So much of the energy has gone into breaking the bat. All right, at the sweet spot, less wave or vibrational energy goes into the bat. More kinetic energy stays in the ball. So let's look at the ways that a bat and a PVC tube can vibrate. I'm going to need a little help here from Zeke to hold the microphone, But I already had help from Zeke because he gave me this 10-foot-long PVC tube. This is our poor man's baseball bat. It won't connect well with a ball, but it will show us waves really nicely. The waves travel more slowly and with greater amplitude in this bat, in this kind of bat. Now, I want to advance here. All right, here's the first so-called mode of bat vibration. Watch what's going on here. Well, I've got a laser, don't I? Here are two spots. These two black spots are places where the bat does not vibrate. They're called nodal points. As the wave courses back and forth through this bat, those points don't move. Again, this is called the first mode of bat vibration. So here in this bat, let's see if we can do that, if I can do that. All right, I want two nodes, and I want a lot of vibration going here and at the end and at the end. So three areas of high vibration, two areas of no vibration. Close? I'm seeing a node up there and a node down there. All right. So the first mode of bat vibration. The second mode. Oh no, sorry. There it is again. Okay, here comes the second mode. Now, this is harder to do. The animation is very quick, too. Notice the black dots again. Each of these black dots, that one, and that one, are sites of no vibration. They're nodal points. The red dot indicates where the node was for the first mode of vibration, one of the two nodes, the node that matters for us as we're trying to hit the ball. So I'm going to try to vibrate this PVC tube so that the wave courses back and forth through it and we get three nodes. Yeah, good luck.
You got it. Try and move out of the way.
I had it briefly.